Major funding for NJTV News is provided in part by RWJ Barnabas Health. Let's be healthy together. NJM Insurance Group, serving the insurance needs of residents and businesses for more than 100 years. And Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield of New Jersey, an independent licensee of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Association.
Tonight on NJTV News, the governor goes to bat for the bridge and tunnel set.
Governor Murphy calls it a win for New Jersey commuters, announcing a deal brokered with New York over the so-called congestion pricing into Manhattan.
16 alleged child predators caught in a sting operation. The attorney general's warning to parents.
Plus, the last convicted Bridgegate co-conspirator finally learns her sentence and has some strong words for her former boss. Those stories and more next on NJTV News.
Live from the Agnes Barris NJTV studio at 2 Gateway Center in Newark, this is NJTV News with Mary Alice Williams.
Hello, thank you for joining us on air and online. It looks like the governor's got a deal in the works to save New Jersey drivers from being penalized by New York's threatened congestion pricing. Brianna Vernozzi was with Governor Murphy in Hackensack. Brianna?
Mary Alice, we're just outside the building where Governor Murphy held his roundtable. Today, he called this agreement with New York conceptual for now, though he sees it as a win for New Jersey commuters, even though the plans to implement this congestion pricing are far from being hashed out. Now, this agreement was actually brokered with New York's Governor Andrew Cuomo late last week. The governor decided he'd unveil the plans today here in Bergen County because he says these are the residents who would be carrying most of the burden if these carve-outs don't happen. Lawmakers have been lobbying hard for exemptions because they say Jersey drivers are getting all the pain, paying more in tolls that have surged quite a bit over the last several years to get into Manhattan, but none of the benefit.
This understanding means that New Jersey commuters will be treated equally at all Hudson River crossings, the Lincoln and Holland tunnels, and the George Washington Bridge. And New Jersey will also have a seat at the table as the plan moves forward. And as we ensure equal treatment for our commuters, we will pursue the conversion, and this is important, to cashless tolling at the Port Authority controlled crossings. This not only will make delivering the credits to New Jersey drivers possible, but it will also relieve congestion at the toll plazas, especially on the George Washington Bridge. It's a fairly straightforward point, but the Lincoln and the Holland already go into the zone itself. So getting that electronic tolling technology in place is less urgent, although it does relieve congestion. It's much more urgent in the George Washington because you've got to keep track of people, including those who may not have Easy Pass, including those who keep driving to Connecticut. So you've got to be able to have that record in order to make the system work.
New York leaders say the money's needed to help fund $15 billion in debt for the MTA's capital program. Now, the governor today said it's unclear if tolls will rise to help offset these exemptions, though he doesn't expect that to happen. But it's also unlikely New Jersey will get any portion of this cash that's being raised. That's something that lawmakers had pushed for in this debate. The conversation quickly turned today to the other big news this week. That's the resignation of the Schools Development Authority CEO Lizette Delgado Polanco. She handed in her resignation letter. It's effective Friday. She's stepping down from the position amid allegations of nepotism and mishandling restructuring at the authority. We asked the governor about it today. He had little to say about who asked her to step down or when. And we also questioned him about her resignation as the vice chair of the Democratic State Party.
Lizette tendered her resignation. I've got no comment or context on timing. I appreciate the work that she did, and we are looking forward, I think sooner than later, in appointing an interim director and turning the page and doing the work that the SDA is so needed to do in this state.
She's been at that for many years, and she did a really good job there. She has stepped down. Peg Schaefer is going to step up and serve as vice chair with my complete support. So in addition to thanking Lizette and continuing to have complete confidence in Chairman Curry,
Meanwhile, Senate President Steve Sweeney today said that Delgado Polanco's resignation was, quote, needed, adding that her departure would allow for a clear review of what's been taking place at the SDA. And you can expect to hear soon about a new appointment, an interim appointment at the SDA. Mary Alice.
Thanks, Brianna. Convicted Bridgegate co-conspirator, former Christie aide Bridget Ann Kelly, is heading to prison for her role in the political retribution scandal that closed George Washington bridge lanes, tarnished the Christie administration, and rocked the state. Raven Santana is at the federal courthouse. Raven.
Mary Alice, Kelly was convicted in November 2016 on charges including wire fraud and civil rights violations. She was sentenced to 18 months in prison. But last year, a federal appeals court tossed out some of the counts and upheld the most serious ones. And today, a federal judge ruled that Kelly will serve 13 months in prison. Immediately following the hearing, we heard from Kelly, who publicly spoke about her resentencing, blaming Governor Christie for her missteps.
The fact that I am here in place of others from the Christie administration and the governor himself does not prove my guilt. It only proves that justice is not blind. Chris Christie was allowed, without rebuttal from anyone, to say out of one side of his mouth that I was a low-level staffer, a woman only good enough to plan menus and invite people to events, then say out of the other side of his mouth that I was somehow powerful to shut down the George Washington Bridge. There is only one person, only one, and he was powerful enough to approve this act. Mr. Christie, you are a bully, and the days of you calling me a liar and destroying my life are over. The truth will be heard, and for the former governor, that truth will be inescapable, regardless of lucrative television deals or even future campaigns. I plan to make sure of that.
That sentencing lasted about an hour. Inside, a judge made it very clear that the facts have not changed since 2013. Kelly will also have to pay more than $14,000 in restitution and fines, and she is set to begin serving that sentence sometime in July. In Newark, Raven Santana, NJTV News. Mary Alice, back to you.
Thank you, Raven. You can see Bridget Kelly's entire statement at njtvnews.org. Presidential candidate Cory Booker has been hopscotching through key states in hopes of gaining money, fans, and all important endorsements. And at one of the nation's largest public, historically black institutions of higher education, he's joined a candidate forum hosted by the organization She the People, focused on issues facing women of color. Senior correspondent David Cruz is on the Booker beat. Dave.
Mary Alice, we're here on the campus of Texas Southern University, one of 10 historically black colleges and universities here in the state of Texas. She the People is a national organization whose mission is to build political power and amplify the voices, particularly of women of color. Today's forum brings together 9 of the men and women running for the Democratic nomination for president, including New Jersey Senator Cory Booker. They will not all be on the stage together at the same time, though.
The forum was co-moderated by Joy-Ann Reed of MSNBC and She the People co-founder Amy Allison. The candidates joined them on stage for questions from both the hosts and members of the audience of about 1,500 or so, mostly women of color.
There are folks, for example, from New Orleans who are restaurant workers who are going to be asking questions. There are going to be a number of people who just want to know, like, what are you going to do to really center our communities in meaningful and powerful ways beyond the rhetoric that we always see from Donald Trump?
The audience included many TSU students, but also Texans from around the state. Their minds mostly not yet made up.
I want to hear about their health care policy because that does affect my job, my future career. I also want to hear about their immigration, their stance on immigration, because I am from the border. My father was born in Mexico, so I am a Mexican girl, so that's actually very important for my family as well.
Who have you heard from and whose message right now is resonating with you?
Well, I think there's a common message of like, being united and like just anyone but Trump, basically. That's the common message I've been hearing.
It would seem to the outside observer that Kamala Harris would be someone who would get an extra look here.
Right. It would seem that way, but I have not decided yet. I really want to hear what each individual has to say and what they're going to do, because all of their messages are pretty much different, and I just really want to see which one would be the most beneficial for my family and the people.
Questions range from foreign policy to gender and economic equality. High-profile candidates included Beto O'Rourke, Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders, Julian Castro, Kamala Harris, and of course, Cory Booker.
We in America owe a debt to the championship and the leadership and the activism of women of color. And so I began my career, as I've said, in a black and brown community. The first person to tell me to run for office was the tenant president of some projects called Brick Towers, who wanted me in the fight and to remember where I came from.
This is a system, in particular around the criminalization of drug use and possession, that has been infected by racial bias. And we have to speak truth about that.
The dreamers today who are standing up not just for themselves, for their parents, the original dreamers, and for immigrants across this country from every place on this planet.
Senator Booker flies out to South Carolina, an important early vote state for him. He will be there for events on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and that will wrap up his two-week Justice for All tour. For now, in Houston, I'm David Cruz, NJTV News. Mary Alice, we'll send it back to you.
Thank you, David. To track the senator's coast-to-coast quest for the White House, head to the BookerBeat.org, where you can find the most comprehensive coverage, including exclusives from NJTV News and NJ Spotlight journalists embedded with the campaign. Is sports betting good business? Rhonda Schaffler is away today. Here with all the business news is Joanna Gagas. Joanna?
Mary Alice, Governor Murphy spoke at the country's largest sports betting conference today. Fitting, as the governor wants to make New Jersey the number one state for wagering. Addressing industry leaders in the Meadowlands, he shared his vision to outpace Nevada as the intellectual and technical capital, which experts say could happen as early as next year.
Over $2 billion has been waged. We have pumped new life and brought new customers to our racetracks and casinos. And our embrace of new technologies, especially mobile platforms, has led to nearly 75% of wagers being placed online.
June will mark 1 year since sports betting was legalized in the state. And while the markets had huge success, Murphy said revenues still don't meet the needs of the state budget. It's a heavily taxed state, but new data shows that tax collections in New Jersey are still below their 2007 peak before the Great Recession drop-off. Adjusting for inflation, the state's tax revenue is down by 1.4%, according to the Pew Charitable Trusts. That puts New Jersey among nine states that are outside of the national average of a 13.4% increase since the recession. To dive deeper into this story, head to njspotlight.com, where John Reitmeier analyzes the numbers and what they mean for the state. Newark-based Prudential Financial is investing in young people around the globe. The company dedicated $180 million to educate and train 15 to 29-year-olds who don't have access to school, training, or regular jobs. It's part of a global effort to improve financial security for young people in more than 70 countries. But a third of the funds, that's $60 million, will stay right here in New Jersey, where the company is headquartered. McDonald's franchisees across the state will hire nearly 4,500 employees before the summer season. They've partnered with AARP to attract experienced seniors in what they're calling a multi-generational hiring push that'll span five generations. Once employed for 90 days, employees can earn a high school diploma, receive college tuition assistance, free education and career counseling, and learn English as a second language. Turning to Wall Street, the markets finished in the red, with the Dow ending down 60 points. And those are your top business stories.
A child sex sting operation has netted 16 people who prosecutors say lurked online preying on local children. Leah Mishkin was there when State Attorney General Gabriel Grewal revealed Operation Home Alone.
These new child predators are a parent's worst nightmare.
A Ridgewood police officer accused of arranging sex with a person he thought was a 15-year-old girl. A teacher at the High School of Computers and Technology in the Bronx, accused of arranging to have sex with a person he thought was a 14-year-old boy.
During that chat, Roth shared his sexual fantasies with an undercover officer who he believed to be that minor boy. He's also accused of asking the minor to send him naked pictures of himself.
Also on the list, a minister and drivers for Uber and Lyft. A total of 16 alleged child predators caught in a sting operation called Operation Home Alone.
They used apps like Kick, Scout, and Grindr to groom their victims and to lure them for sex.
But instead of finding a child home alone, most of them showed up to an apartment where dozens of police officers and evidence technicians were waiting to arrest them.
The 16 alleged child predators we arrested came from New Jersey, New York State, and Philadelphia.
In the past, child predators used to stalk children at playgrounds, at schoolyards, at shopping malls. Now, they lurk on social media, using chat apps and gaming platforms. The apps that you see on this board are just some of the ones that we've encountered in our many, many investigations of this type.
Attorney General Kabir Graywall warning parents and family members to be on guard and to monitor their children's social media apps.
Are their chats restricted to their friends, or are strangers able to chat with them? Parents need to be vigilant, and they need to tell their children, do not share any personal information with strangers on the internet.
Because the multi-agency operation caught 16 alleged child predators in less than 5 days.
I hate to say this, but if we extended that operation to a weekly basis, I imagine we would pick up 16 defendants at least a week, because there are those child predators out there that are using the anonymity of the internet.
Those that are at home thinking to go on, that if they think they're talking to a 14-year-old girl or boy, I hope in the back of their mind they think that they're talking to a New Jersey state trooper or to a detective in a prosecutor's office.
We want child predators to know that we're going to catch them.
Most of the defendants face charges of luring and attempted sexual assault of a minor. Those are second-degree charges, and each carries a sentence of up to 10 years. Leah Mishkin, NJTV News.
Reclaiming history, that tops tonight's Garden State Express. Our first stop, Northfield, where a band of filmmaking Jersey boys will celebrate a blast from their own past at a renovated retro theater. William Murray once managed the Tilton Nine, now reopening as the Tilton Square, where Murray's 1984 vintage directorial debut film Primal Scream will have its South Jersey debut. The futuristic sci-fi film noir was shot on a shoestring and never did make it to the big screens, but the time capsule of early 1980s South Jersey will be shown here, along with a documentary about making the film titled Made a Movie, Live to Tell. Next to Haddonfield, in the running for America's best historic small town. It dates back to a late 1600s bricklayer, though the first nearly complete skeleton of a dinosaur found in North America was here earlier. In the 1700s, the New Jersey legislature met at the Indian King Tavern to dodge British troops during the War for Independence. In the 1800s, the mayor says it was the go-to summer respite for Philadelphians dodging disease and dysentery, until he says folks could skip Haddonfield and take the train down the shore to, say, Cape May, the state's only other historic small town in the running. The oldest seashore resort in America was first charted by a Dutch captain in the 1600s, but is famous for its more than 600 buildings erected in the 1900s, including colorful vintage Victorians, summer places, old shops, and hotels all comprise a registered historic district. Only 20 towns in the nation have been nominated for a spot on USA Today's 10 Best Historic Small Towns. Anyone 18 and older can vote once per day until Monday, May 6th at noon. Vote early and often. And that's the Garden State Express for Wednesday, April 24th. Something up in your neighborhood, tip us off. We'll be right back. Cybercrime, ransomware, dangers lurking on the dark web. Experts from New Jersey Cybersecurity and Communications Integration Cell addressed both technological threats and the technology that can stop them cold. Michael Hill was there.
When electronic bike thefts kept growing in Holland, bike sellers installed IBM's blockchain technology to track every time someone opened or closed a bike's electronic lock and to show its GPS location. An owner using a phone app could report the theft to police, who share the information with insurance companies.
Before this process was in place, you're calling the police to report your bike being stolen, you're calling the insurance company to report the theft. Now, basically, you handled it with basically a couple clicks on your smartphone.
It's one example of how companies are using technology to thwart crime. An example shared at William Patterson University's 5th Annual Cybersecurity and Big Data Analytics Symposium. An analyst with the New Jersey Cybersecurity and Communications Integration Cell, or NJKIC, on what to do with suspicious-looking email.
Just to be mindful of what are you looking at and before you click on anything. And make sure that if you do receive any emails, you know, if there are any links or attachments in them, you know, verify with the sender. It just takes 2 seconds to make that phone call and confirm with them.
FBI Cyber Task Force Supervisory Special Agent Brett Yeager demonstrated how criminals hit the darknet to do their dirty work, even ones behind bars.
Basically wanted to purchase a mail bomb to send to his ex-wife, who's trying to go through it was murder for hire plot is what it ended up being.
The conference could easily bear the subtitle of Businesses Beware, That, and Protection. Yeager warned about ransomware, an attack on a company's system to steal or block access to its own records and information, unless it pays a ransom.
Say, let's get a team together. Let's assume that we just got smacked in the face with a ransomware attack. How are we as a company going to respond to this?
An IBM cybersecurity architect offered a simple solution.
Does anybody know what the best, or actually the only way to really recover from ransomware other than paying the ransom? What do you have to do? Backup.
It's a growing concern.
Growing in frequency, growing in sophistication, and ransom demanded. New Jersey's Chief Information Security Officer, Michael Garrity, on what to do.
Cyber hygiene is everything from, you know, strong passwords to security awareness training for employees and students here, to everything from making sure systems are patched with the latest security patches, making sure antivirus and anti-malware programs are up to date and running. All of those things that are more or less common sense make up that cyber hygiene program.
Garrity says there are two kinds of companies, ones that have been breached and ones that don't know they have been breached. In Wayne, Michael Hill, NJTV News.
Tonight, NJ Spotlight's Carly Citrin is headed to Rutgers for a Board of Governors hearing. Carly, what's on the agenda?
So the hearing is expected to be on tuition fees and other charges at the university. And at the same time, we are expecting part-time lecturers, which is Rutgers' word for adjunct professors, to come out and speak about their status at the university.
Okay, we look forward to reading about it tomorrow, Carly. Thanks. You can sign up for their daily newsletter. Go to njspotlight.com and click on NJ Spotlight Newsletters. And now some noteworthy facts that help you know Jersey. Operation Home Alone is the second sting operation targeting child predators in New Jersey in the past year. William Patterson is the second oldest of New Jersey's 9 state colleges and universities, founded in 1855. Cornelius Jacobson May explored and charted Cape May from 1611 to 1614. And the first European settler of Haddonfield was bricklayer Francis Collins. If there's someone who you'd like to get to know Jersey, share. Use hashtag NoJersey. Tomorrow on NJTV News, a look at how the specific medical needs of the LGBTQ population are being served. To share any story you've seen tonight, go to njtvnews.org. I'm Mary Alice Williams. For all the men and women of NJTV, thanks. See you tomorrow.
The
Independent College Fund of New Jersey, in partnership with Accenture, a global management firm providing strategy, consulting, digital, and technology services. The members of the New Jersey Education Association, making public schools great for every child. And PSE&G, we make things work for communities.
PSE&G is building New Jersey's clean energy future. We're working to protect our network against extreme weather, expanding and upgrading transmission lines, and modernizing our natural gas system by installing new, more durable underground pipes. At PSE&G, our goal is to make sure you have the safe, reliable energy you need to power your life now and into the future.
For over 85 years, in every county across the state, we've protected the health of New Jersey, covering families and businesses through life's big moments and the small ones. Because we don't just work here, we live here too. Over 5,000 local employees, all with the same purpose, taking care of you.
Look at these kids.
How are you?
What do you see? I see myself. I became an ESL teacher to give my students what I wanted when I came to this country. The opportunity to learn, to dream, to achieve, a chance to belong and to be an American. My name is Julia Toriani Crompton, and I'm proud to be an NJEA member.